Hey everybody, welcome to T-Roy Cooks. Appreciate you joining us again for another Thursday chatting with Troy. And again, got my list of questions here. Questions that you find folks have asked of me, and I'm going to go ahead and answer them for you. That's what this is all about, these Thursday chats. You ask questions in the comment section down below the videos. I'll add them to my list, go back and answer them at a later date for you. And again, I mentioned it last week, if it's something you need an urgent response to, let me know. That way that you don't have to wait for me to answer it. It could be a month out down the line when I answer your question. If there's anything that I may mention, any YouTubers, channels I may mention, they'll be down in the description box below. If there's any products that you're interested in I may mention, check the description box. Put a lot of information in the description box. In fact, I would like for y'all to let me know. Do y'all actually look at the description box, or am I wasting my time putting information down there for you? Because that probably takes, depending on the length of these videos, it may take me a couple hours to go through and put all that stuff in the description box. So, just curious. Let me know. Keep the feedback coming. Glad y'all still enjoying this. Let's get down to it. Let's see what we got this week. Nick Mancini, how do you store leftovers from a pork butt or a brisket? And how do you reheat the meat? I never get the same quality as the day I cook the meat. I find myself drowning leftovers in barbecue sauce to make up for the dried out meats. Thanks. Yeah, Nick, that is a good question, and I think I've partially answered this one before. Cheers to you. And again, I know I'm gonna get some questions. What is this? Karen found it on Amazon. Looks pretty cool, upside down beer bottle. But I'll see if I can find it. I'll put it in the description box, a link for it, or my Amazon affiliate links. Back to Nick's question though. If I'm gonna be storing my barbecue meat for, I don't know, more than a week, what I'll do is vacuum seal it and put it in the freezer. And then when I reheat it, whether it be ribs or brisket or pork butt or whatever, a lot of times, you know, if it's pork butt, I'm gonna probably throw some kind of vinegar-based barbecue sauce on it anyway, so I'll reheat it in some sauce. If I'm doing it like for some breakfast tacos or enchiladas or nachos, a lot of times, you know, I may steam it just to warm it up a little bit, or I'll make like a foil pack and put a little touch of water in there for a little steam and just stick it in the fridge, stick it in the oven for a little bit. And the same thing goes with brisket and ribs and stuff. Just wrap it up a little bit if you need to, if it's got some barbecue sauce already on it and you're worried about that barbecue sauce eating through the foil. Wrap your meat in some plastic wrap and then wrap it in foil and put that in your oven and reheat it a little bit that way. I've actually answered this for some briskets though, and some of my fine followers such as you out there, y'all left comments, and that's the other thing too with these Thursday chats. Y'all read through the comments section, because after the video, if somebody out there has a better answer than what I give on this video chat, they'll put it in the description box, and I appreciate all the feedback. You know, I'm not perfect. I don't answer everything off the cuff that I may think about later on while I'm editing. I'll think of all kind of other stuff I could have said on camera, but I just answer these questions. You know, I don't think ahead of time what my answer is going to be. I read the question, I answer it just off the top of my head. So there's some things that I do mess up on. There's some things that I miss, some things I forget. So yeah, check out the comments below. And if you've got some feedback, go ahead and leave it. I appreciate it. But one of my previous videos, I'd mentioned how to reheat brisket. And I think I said pretty much the same thing, you know, wrap it in some foil with a little water and you can reheat it in your oven. I was assuming that brisket that question was asked of me, I was assuming it was the whole, you know, a slab of brisket, not sliced already. If it's already sliced, some of my other feedback I got from some of my followers said, just put you a little bit of oil in your skillet or something and fry them babies up, and they'll get kind of crispy on the outside, which is nice. Give them a little extra flavor, and that'll reheat them. It doesn't take very long, but that works great for sliced brisket. Yeah, that's what I would do, man. Just I don't like slathering it down with barbecue sauce to try to warm it up, again, unless it's pulled pork. But the other stuff, I just put it in some foil and put it in the oven. Works great for me. And vacuum sealing it and putting it in the freezer, heck, it'll last 6 months or so. Let's see, Ryan Talbot. Hey, Troy, love the vids, man. Well done getting Greg. Yeah, that was fun getting Ballistic Barbecue. That's Greg. a good friend of mine out in San Diego, man. It was great having Greg join me. And Ryan says he's always watching Greg's videos as well. Yeah, I'm sure that a lot of us that do these cooking channels on YouTube, you know, we've all got pretty much the same followers, you know. So it's nice having a little small community like this going on where you guys can interact with us and we can interact with you, and we do appreciate the support very much. Thank you. All right, Ryan's got a quick question. Any tips on lowering the temperatures of a Weber kettle when they just get too hot? On my offset, I just open the lid for 10 seconds or so, but I can't do that on the kettle. It just adds more oxygen to the charcoal. He says, I tried spraying it with water, but it seems to create a crappy smoke that probably won't make the food taste good. You're right, man. Yeah, if you try to spray it down or mist it with some water, man, that's gonna, all that soot and the ash is gonna fly up and that smoke is gonna not be good at all for the meat, man. As I mentioned before, I've never owned a Weber kettle, so I'm guessing. Some of you that have the Weber kettles, feel free to leave the your feedback in the comments for these guys. I think if you've tried lowering the actual air getting in by shutting those bottom vents to try to smother the fire a little bit, if that's not working for you, the only other thing I can think of, man, would be to remove some of those charcoals. You know, put them in something metal where you're not going to burn through it, but just take some out and see if that works for you. I was going to say, you may try having some wet wood chips, not chunks, but wood chips. If you have some wet wood chips on hand, you can probably put those onto your fire and that'll smolder it down, and it won't really get all the ash and soot off of the charcoal and get up into your meat. So that may work for you as well. But again, read through the comments on this video after a day or two and see if some of my YouTube friends out there that have the Weber kettle can better answer that for you. But great question, Ryan. I'm sure quite a few people run into that. Peter Van Gulick, do you ever cook in a Dutch oven? Yes, I do. Quite often, in fact. If yes, what are your favorite recipes? Man, I'll tell you, I like doing beef tips, which I've got a video on. And I like doing a stew. Let's see. Jambalaya works real well. And like some etouffee. I like crawfish and shrimp etouffees. That work really well. Man, you cook all kinds of stuff in Dutch ovens. You can even cook like a Sunday roast with carrots and potatoes in your Dutch oven. Works out great. Good stuff, man. Good stuff. Gumbo. I forgot about gumbo. Gumbo's really good in a Dutch oven, man. I love it, cast iron. Scott Parker, what's the best full meal with protein, sides, and veggies you've cooked? For example, a one-burner meal for six. I've never really had to run into that because I've always had more than one burner and I've never had a family of six. But I see what you're getting at, though. Let me give us some thought. Hang on. Cheers to you. Let's see. I was just mentioning a stew. That would go a long ways for six people. All in one pot. You got your carrots, potatoes, what other veggies you want to throw in there. Heck, when it's done, you can even pull it out and put that in another bowl and make your rice in your Dutch oven. So that would work. I mentioned jambalaya. Jambalaya is fantastic, man. That'll feed a bunch of people. And I'm trying to think what'll feed six people here. You can do some type of an Asian, like a Chinese dish, you know, stir fry. Pepper steak. Pepper steak works great in one pot dish. So there's quite a bit you can do for one burner, and you can be creative with it too, man. But as far as feeding a lot of people all at once, I'd probably say something like a jambalaya or some type of stew. That's what I would go with. Appreciate the question. That's a good question, Scott. Small town barbecue. Great video again, buddy. Hope to meet you one day coming down from San Antonio, Texas. I can't stand cooking chicken, but the family loves it. My question is, how do I get my skin crispy without burning it or over drying the meat itself? I see people brine their chicken, but some say it makes the skin more rubbery and some say it doesn't. I've really only ever brined my chicken once, and that was when I was going to fry it, deep fry it. And it works great with that. I've never brined it and then put it into the smoking chamber, smoker. But I would say that usually when I do smoked chicken, I do start it off at 225, 250, somewhere in that range. And when it gets about 3/4 of the way through the cook, you know, when the meat and the bird starts getting, I don't know, 130-ish, 140, somewhere in that range, then I'll crank the heat up. And that will crisp up the skin on the chicken. You know, crank it up 275 or 300, even 325. And it'll finish cooking the chicken, but at the same time crisp up that skin. That would be my suggestion. And I have heard the same thing about skin on the chicken turning out kind of rubbery if you brine it. Perhaps that's the solution you brine it in. I don't really know. But that's something I can probably test out and do some videos showing. So, great suggestion too. Appreciate it. Joe Ease. Hope I'm pronouncing your name right there, Joe. Wouldn't the pellicle formed by the seasoning or the cold smoking act as a protective barrier during the dry aging? Oh. Probably about 4 or 5 Thursday chats ago, Keith Bedtag came up with a question for me about dry aging and smoking dry aged meat. And we were trying to figure out which would be whether you can do that. You know, smoke the meat and then dry age it, or dry age it and then smoke it. And I had quite a few follow-up, you know, people that left their feedback. In fact, John, Big Meat Sunday, he commented back, leaving some feedback. He smokes his meat. Is that right? Smokes it and then dry ages it? Pretty sure. Maybe I'm thinking, no, I'm thinking about smoking it in the sous vide. That's what I'm thinking about. Getting my Thursday chats mixed up, folks. Y'all, pardon me. But, yeah, man, I'm thinking, I forget what I thought that time, but right now I'm really thinking that, I mean, I know you can smoke the meat after it's dry aged. That's a given. You can do that. But smoking it before you dry age it, I still think that'd be a great test. That's something I probably would want to do and just check out. But Andy's question here, I'm sorry, Joe's question, sorry. Joe's question is talking about the pellicle, and the pellicle is, when you smoke meat, you have that bright red ring right around the outer edge of the meat. That's the pellicle. And Joe's thinking that perhaps that pellicle will protect the meat when you dry age it after you smoked it. So I bet you're right, Joe, but I'd want to try that myself, and man, it'd make a great video. All right, now we're getting to Andy's question. Andy Olson, my question today for you, Troy. Do you ever go to any crawfish or shrimp boils? Yeah, Andy, I do. Usually just one per year, except for my own. I want to make it down to Booger's. Booger 500 US. Y'all go check her out. She does a crawfish boil every year, but so does JB, Louisiana Cajun Recipes. He has his annual spring fling every year, and it should be coming up here in late April, early May, usually is when he has it. And a bunch of us YouTubers get together. Y'all heard me talk about it, and you've probably seen my videos along with other YouTubers that are there shooting videos. It's like a press conference event, man. Cameras are everywhere. Mics are everywhere. It's fun. But the food is excellent. Crawfish bowls, man. Yeah. JB Spring Fling. Y'all check the description box. I'll put links to all the channels I'm mentioning down there. Just hit show more to get to the description box down there. And I'll put JB's channel up here just to show him some love. I hadn't done that in a while. What else you got for me here? Andy, he says, I hear they are amazing down there. Yeah. Yeah, we do crawfish bowls, shrimp bowls, seafood bowls. People throw in whole corn on the cob, whole onions, potatoes, other veggies with the seafood, and just dump them right on the folding table when done. Are there any resources for us to live outside of Texas? Yeah, man, I've got a couple of crawfish bowl videos, actual seafood boils, but there was crawfish in the mix, so I called it a crawfish boil. So I'll put one of those up here for you. You can check that out if you haven't seen it already. And as far as getting crawfish outside of Texas or outside of Louisiana, there are a couple of different places that I would recommend One of them is Tony's Seafood out of Baton Rouge, tonysseafood.com, I believe. And the other one is LA Crawfish for LouisianaCrawfish.com, I believe is their website. Check the description box. I'll put the links down there for you. But they both ship live crawfish to you. They're not previously frozen or anything. And they ship them overnight to you. So shipping may be a little expensive, but depending on where you live, you can get some live crawfish that way. And Tony's is where I would really recommend from. Tony's does a great job. That's where JB gets his crawfish when he does the spring flings. Pardon me. My lips is chapped. Good stuff. When I just did that, I remember seeing Phil, Daddy Cooks, do that. Phil's a great friend too, man. I like that, man. Tim Camholtz. Troy, can you use all wood in the Weber Smoky Mountain for cooking? Yeah, Tim, you could, but I would not recommend it. The wood just, it burns too hot, in my opinion. I guess if you're doing chicken or something like that, you could, but then again, too, you probably get a little too much smoke on your meat. Because the intake, even though there's three vents down on that Weber Smoky Mountain base, I don't think there's enough air intake and enough exhaust out of the lid to get proper airflow, so you're going to get a ton of smoke, in my opinion. I've never tried it, but that would be my guess. Plus, it's going to burn hotter. So, I don't know, man. Give it a shot. Let me know. I don't think I'll be trying it, though. Ryan Hiltz. T-Roy, I was wondering what you smoke your chicken or turkey at. I tried 225 degrees, and the meat comes out nice, but the skin's rubbery. Should I turn up the heat towards the end of the cook? Or bring the whole cook up to 275 or so? Yeah, in fact, that's what I was just talking about. You know, I like to cook about 225, 250-ish, and then 3/4 of the way through the cook, I'll go ahead and crank the heat up, and that'll crisp that skin up. And the other thing that I have done on turkey, I take some, cheesecloth. Take some cheesecloth, wrap it around your bird, or just put a layer over the breast section, actually, the top of it. And then coat olive oil or real melted butter over the cheesecloth to keep it moist. And then put that in your oven or put that in your smoker. And that cheesecloth will let the smoke still get to the meat. Plus, it'll help protect it from drying out. And it'll give you a real, real nice, deep color. It's really beautiful, man. I've done that before on video. Check that out. Oh, and a lot of folks too, y'all ask me if I've done videos on this or that. If you go to my channel, T-Roy Cooks, go to my homepage, you'll see the about and videos and playlists and all that. Over to the right side of all those different buttons you can press, it's kind of midway down, but over to the right side, just above where my videos and stuff are, you see a little box with a question mark, I think it's a question mark. If you type in that box and then hit that question mark, search is what it does. It'll search my channel, not all of YouTube, but just my channel. It'll search my channel for brisket. It'll search my channel for chicken or whatever, you know, whatever you're thinking about doing, crawfish boil, you know. So y'all check that out. It's a pretty handy feature. In fact, I don't remember the names of all my videos. That's what I do. When I get a question about something, like a crawfish boil, that's what I do. I go to my homepage, and the little box over to the right side, above my videos, but below my main header, my main background, that pretty Jetsons old retro-style movie theater background I got up there. I love it. Karen created that for me, by the way. Just type in what you're searching for, and then hit the search. The little question mark thing, I believe, is what it is, and they'll search for you on my channel. Let's see. I think you had some more stuff here, Ryan. Let me see. He says, I have a smoker very similar to your Yoder. I'm looking at the Vision Kamado smoker now, and it looks like a really nice smoker. I'm going to buy it soon, but was wondering if you prefer one over the other. Thanks, and great job with your videos. Cheers to you, and Keith Bettag from New York. Appreciate that, Ryan. Cheers to you there, big fella. Let's see. I'm just old school. I like my offset. But you know, if I'm like want to sear a steak, or if I want to just really high temp cook a pizza or something, I use my Kamado. So it's nice that I have both, you know, that I can choose which cooker I want to cook something on. You can do pretty much everything on the Kamado Joe, more so than what you can do on the Yoder Wichita. But like I told you before, I've got that grill grate that I can stick over my wood in my firebox, and I can grill or sear steaks directly over the wood, which is a really, really nice flavor. Really nice. That's my favorite way to do a steak, man, over direct wood like that. Oh my God, is that good. Really good. All right, Ryan, I think I got your questions answered there. I appreciate it. Balls Deep Capel, or Capel. Sorry about that. Let's see. Hey, man, like your videos. I have an Oklahoma Joe smoker, and I hate it. Oh, bummer. Sorry, man. He says it doesn't hold temperature at all. Just thinking about getting a pellet smoker. What do you think about those? Yeah, I think you'll really enjoy a pellet smoker over the Oklahoma Joe. In fact, just last week I had somebody leave some feedback because, again, I was talking about some char griller grills. And he said he's got a char griller offset and it works just fine for him. So, you know, I'm not perfect. I've never owned char griller. I've never owned the Oklahoma Joe. I'm just going by what I've read, what I've heard, what I've experienced my other friends have told me about, you know. So, I think you would really like the pellet over the Oklahoma Joe personally. I mean, they really cook some good food. Plus, they're easy maintenance, man. I mean, you don't have to plug a thing in, set the temp, load it with some pellets, you're good to go. So go for it, man. All right, Dan Reeves. Hi, Troy. Great job with all your videos. Great information. I appreciate the support, Dan. Thank you very much, man. Let's see. What you got for me, Dan? I've been looking for a good wireless meat thermometer and was wondering what you recommend. Thanks. I recommend the Maverick ET733, I think it is, and also the ThermoWorks Smoke. Both of those are wireless. Both of those hold a meat probe and a pit probe, so you can monitor the pit temps. And they're wireless, so you can leave the main base at your pit, walk away up to, you know, 300 feet clear distance. If you're going through walls and stuff, maybe 200 feet or 150 so. But you get that wireless handheld device that you can monitor your temps with. You can set the alarms on it to go off if the temps get too high or too low. I will say the ThermoWorks Smoke, which just recently came out, it hadn't been out that long, but I've got one and I like it a whole lot better. It's a lot easier to set the temps on, and it's more durable. It's heavier, so I like that about it as well. But either one, the Maverick or the ThermoWorks Smoke, will work. In fact, if you're interested in buying any ThermoWorks devices, check my links in the description box. It won't cost you a dime more, but it'll help me out because I'll get a little few cents off of every sale if you click the affiliate links I have in my description box. So I'd appreciate it. Steve Zuffa. Oh, and Dan, I think the Smoke sells right around $100 and the Maverick somewhere around 60 or maybe 70, so that you'll pay a little more for the Smoke, but buddy, it is worth it in my opinion. It really is, and I'm not just saying that because I'm a feeling. I'm being honest with you. If I don't like something, I'm not gonna promote it. I'm not gonna promote it on my videos. I'm not gonna talk about it. So, just my 2 cents, man. Well worth it though. Steve Zuffa. Hey guys, great video. I was thinking about the pit barrel cooker and then seen Baby Back Maniac's video on how he sets up his Weber Smoky Mountain with an accessory, and it looked like the same type of setup as the pit barrel cooker. With doing that type of setup, which smoker would you recommend? Well, kind of depends on if you've already got a Weber Smoky Mountain. If you do, then I would use the setup that Justin Baby Back Maniac was using. I think that accessories, I don't know, it's probably not too expensive, maybe 50, 60 bucks. And it can do what the pit barrel cooker can do. So kind of have the best of both worlds. If you don't already have a Weber Smoky Mountain, depending on your budget, pit barrel cooker may be the way to go for you. Oh, and I think last time I mentioned it was like $1.99, including shipping. I think it's actually $2.99. Somebody corrected me on that. So I misspoke on that price for the pit barrel cooker. I apologize. But either one works fine. The you know, I guess you could. They're really similar, honestly. I think you can pretty much do whatever you can do on the Weber Smoky Mountain on the pit barrel cooker, depending on how you have the grates and stuff set up in there, and if you want to install some type of water pan or something in there, you know, you can accessorize it as you want. And they both do pretty much the same type of style of cooking with that accessory in the Weber Smoky Mountain, that is, you know. So I've already got a Weber Smoky Mountain, and I've got the pit barrel cooker, which I still have yet to cook on because it's been raining. And I've actually been cooking inside recently because it's been raining. So that's why my videos have been inside recently, for cooking on Tuesdays. But yeah, I need to get that pit barrel cooker fired up, man. I'm itching to cook on that thing just to see what it'll do. Appreciate the question, Steve. Eric MDY. Hey, Troy, love the videos, man. Lots of good information. Quick question for you. Have you ever tried Dale's liquid seasoning? Yeah, I have, and it's good stuff, man. In fact, JB turned me on to that Louisiana Cajun recipes. So, yeah, it's good stuff, man. It's a nice marinade. I can get it locally, you know, but I like Worcestershire sauce a little bit better myself. I don't know, man. Maybe it's the tamarind in there, the anchovies. I don't know what it is in there, but I like the Liam Perrin's Worcestershire myself. He says, if you haven't tried it, you should give it a try. It's sort of like Worcestershire sauce. Yeah, and I've seen quite a few people use it as a substitute for Worcestershire sauce, basically. So I'm sure it works great. I've tried it. I just like Worcestershire a little bit better myself. Mad Dog, isn't that right? Yeah, Mad Dog, 8148. Mad Dog, my man Mad Dog. Let me see. T. Roy, my man, does your family originally come from New York or New Jersey area? The reason I ask is because you have an accent that sounds like, at one time, you're from the New York metropolitan area with a southern twang. It's a cool accent. Keep me posted. Oh, and keep up these great videos. They're the best on YouTube. I appreciate that, Mad Dog. Hey, cheers to you, man. Cheers to you. I've got an accent. Isn't that what everybody says, it has an accent? Anyway. No, my family's all from the Baton Rouge area around Louisiana, and I don't know, I can't explain why you think I've got an accent from the New York metropolitan area. I just don't know, but I've had people tell me I've got a radio voice, so I don't know. Tell you who's got a nice radio voice is Dan, Smoky Goodness, and also Tango Joe. All right, nope, from Baton Rouge, Louisiana, buddy. There you go. Jake Berman. T-Roy, love your videos. Thanks for sharing all the tips on the Weber Smoky Mountain. Question for you. Here we go, Jake. What's the best way to reheat barbecue ribs without drying them out? Aha. Different person asking the same type of question I already answered. So, Jake, I hope I got that answer to you. I wrap them in foil, put a little bit of water or something in there, and beef broth, put them in the oven for a little bit. That's what I like to do. Works for me. And doesn't dry them out a whole lot because you're keeping them covered, and they basically are steaming in that liquid wrapped in foil. So anyway, folks, that's all I got. I've actually got some more questions. That's all I have on this list. I've done gone through that list. Now I got to print another list, and that'll last me 3 or 4 videos, I guess. But again, keep the questions coming. I appreciate all the feedback. For y'all out there that want to let me know what you think about the description box. Am I wasting my time putting that information in there? Would you want me to keep putting that information in there because it's helpful to you? Let me know. And if y'all got feedback on any of the answers that I may have answered incorrectly, or you just want to put your input out there because you've got experience cooking on one of these cookers that I haven't, feel free to add your opinion, your feedback, man. I appreciate it, and I'm sure it'll help a lot of people who also read through my comments. But man, it's a great show. Can't thank y'all enough. I do appreciate doing this for each and every one of you. Keep the questions coming. Just leave them in the comments down below. And again, if it's an urgent question, let me know so I'll answer you in the comments instead of putting it on my list. But I hope y'all enjoy this kind of stuff. I think you are. I'm getting a lot of positive feedback on this. So y'all keep it up. I'll keep doing what I'm doing. Y'all like this, y'all give me a thumbs up. I hope y'all share this video. When you do, tell all your friends, T-Roy cooks responsibly. Cheers, everybody.